So three great matches to look ahead to tonight. We're going to start our build-up with Portugal versus Morocco. And actually, obviously, Portugal come into this, having salvaged that 3-3 draw against Spain. It was a Cristiano Ronaldo show, though, wasn't it? And now they have to reset for this match against Morocco because there were a few deficiencies in their performance, perhaps specifically in defence against Spain.
Yeah, for sure. I don't think it was a convincing performance by Portugal. I thought the 3-3 flattered them a little bit. I thought Spain was in total control. Obviously, key moments in the game. Obviously, Ronaldo wins an early penalty, so Spain are on the back foot. Then they score another one against the run of play for me. So it's not plain sailing for the Portuguese. They play a 4-4-2. They are fairly defensive. They get quite narrow across the middle, so they invite the opposition full-back onto them. You know, we see Nacho score a goal from the right-back position because of the way that the Portuguese system is. And for me, I think this will be a tough game. We're looking across the day's games and you think Spain at a certainty, for me, Uruguay a certainty, and everyone's saying Portugal, but I'm not too sure. I wouldn't be surprised if it's a draw.
A lot of changes are being touted in the Portuguese lineup, perhaps in the centre of defence, because, Pepe and Jose Fonte didn't really have the most convincing game against Spain, did they? Would you tweak a centre-back pairing this early in the competition?
Depending on who's fit and who's not, but normally your central defenders are what you go with. It's a big decision to move those. You know, central defenders are all about relationships, about understandings. You know, your back line's really important. You know, do you squeeze up? Do you drop off? Where do you set your benchmark, your foundation? I played central defence and it is about a relationship. You know, if you're about to play offside, you need to know where your other one is. So if he's come out and he's gone with Fonte and Pepe to start with, he needs to be confident and stick with that. So to change it is a big decision.
Not a lot of creativity for Portugal in that match against Spain. You saw Cristiano Ronaldo, coming in deep to try and get the ball, to create the moves, that got them forward. Where does that sort of creativity for them come from? Do they need a change of personnel there?
Well, you look at Bernardo Silva, obviously Manchester City player. You know, he's gone from there for a good fee. He's a decent player. But then when you start thinking of who else can affect the game in an attacking perspective, I think they're struggling a little bit. Obviously, we see Bruno on the right-hand side. Bruno Fernandes got substituted by Quismeira. Quismeira is not a bad player, but he's 33, 34. So, you know, if you're coming off for a 33, 34-year-old, you're obviously, flattering to deceive. And you look right across the side and there isn't anybody but Ronaldo, really, that you would get in most other, world-class sides, if you like. So I think they do struggle in the attacking perspective for sure.
And given the kind of performance that we saw Morocco put up against Iran until that 95th minute own goal, they look defensively solid. They look like a team quite capable, of stopping a team that does not give a lot of service to their frontmen.
Yeah, certainly. They've got some good players in the side. They're quite a few of the players. Ziyech, for example, I think he was player of the year for Ajax. A playmaker, decent player. People tipped him. I think he could have actually qualified for Holland in 2016, but he chose to represent his father's and his mother's nation, which is Morocco. So he's a very good player. And they play with a little bit of freedom, a little bit of flair. That we know that the Moroccans have flair. And they were unfortunate against Iran. I think they're in total control and obviously got done with a sucker punch in the 95th minute.
Which way is this going to go, Ashley?
Well, I don't like Portugal's system. I think they've got to take the game to Morocco a little bit more. They always kind of sit back in your two backs of four and rely on Cristiano Ronaldo. So for me, I wouldn't be surprised if it's a draw. But if Ronaldo's on fire, which he can produce, then it's hard to stop Ronaldo. So, but I'll still say a draw.
You still say a draw. Okay, let's look at the other match in Group B, because 2010 World Champion Spain take on Iran in Kazan. They're also searching for their first win of the tournament. What Jose Mourinho had to say there, he feels Spain are Spain. And really, they have nothing to be concerned about after that performance against Portugal. They would have felt robbed by the draw that Ronaldo managed to secure at the end. But all in all, it was a good performance from Spain, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think it was. I think out of all the games I've seen, I think these look the best, as in a football inside. Yes, they're a little bit deceptible to a counter-attack, but the control of the football they had across the middle of the park, Iniesta and Isco in particular, were fantastic. Busquets never really gives the ball away. And then they have the added dimension of the hustle and bustle and Diego Costa trying to run down the sides of central defenders. Mm. So for me, they played some fantastic football, and I wouldn't be surprised if they beat these comfortably. It's hard to play against Spain because they have so many good footballers, so many players that come into the little pockets of space. You know, they're playing a 4-2-3-1, if you like. The wide players come in nice and narrow. They have two central midfielders that can all control the football, Koke and Busquets that I've mentioned. And then like I said up front, they have the pace and power and the clinical finishing of Diego Costa. So for me, these look a good side. I think these are the ones to beat for anybody in the tournament, if I'm being honest.
Do you think Iran have a shot of trying to stop them? Because, we heard the coach speak before the match and he says we have no problems in admitting that we have absolutely nothing to lose in this match. It's a tough one for them, but a one where Spain also have a little bit of margin for error, because you'd feel that for Spain and Portugal, if they get to 5 points in this group, they'd probably go through, right?
I think that's the thinking of Iran as well. You know, if they draw the next two games, they're also on 5 points. Yeah. So I think they'll be desperately trying to defend. 10 players behind the ball, obviously the goalkeeper as well. And they'll just make it hard for Spain to break them down. But if we see an early goal from Spain, then the floodgates will open. But that will definitely be Iran's game plan. You can't open up against Spain when you're nowhere near as good as them. And that's what's going to happen. So it'll be a really defensive display. And they'll try and hit Spain on the counter-attack. But for me, I can only ever see one winner here.
Want to give us a quick prediction?
I think 4-0 Spain.
4-0, that's a big convincing victory. Of course, that is the action coming up in Group B, but all eyes in Russia will be on the second of the Group A fixtures today, because it's Uruguay taking on Minos Saudi Arabia in Rostov-on-Don, where a victory for the South Americans will seal their place in the knockouts alongside the hosts. Here are the thoughts of the two teams ahead of the match. This is an interesting one, isn't it, Ashley? Because you had that drubbing that Saudi Arabia suffered, so obviously they didn't have the greatest of matches. Uruguay actually picked up the 3 points, but their performance wasn't impressive either. So this is a chance for Uruguay to really get their tournament started.
Yeah, I think so. And you have to see, you know, what system is Saudi Arabia going to go with. They tried to be defensive in their first game against Russia with a 4-1-4-1. You know, they were all over the place at the back, sitting back. The back four was not on the same wavelength. You know, sixes and sevens, there was holes everywhere. It was almost a schoolboy's performance. You won't see in a World Cup, a defensively poor performance as what we've seen. And Uruguay, for me, they did enough in the game. Obviously, they scored late, so it looks like they haven't played that well. But I still was fairly impressed with Uruguay. Suarez and Cavani up front caused a lot of problems. Jimenez obviously scored from the set piece, but I thought he was very comfortable in defence. Mm. Really strong in the air as well, won all his headers. And I expect Uruguay to win this one comfortably. I don't think Saudis can recover from what's happened.
Uruguay were guilty of starting slow in their previous match, weren't they? The tempo of their passing, the transitions from the back to the midfield. Is that an area that they'll be looking at for this particular fixture, just in try and get that tempo up?
Yeah, I think they need probably a little bit of an added dimension. You know, them two, they try and play 4-4-2 as well with Cavani and Suarez up front. They need to be a little bit more flexible. Maybe one of them has to drop into that hole to link things up, or maybe they push a midfielder further up to have that void, really, from midfield into attack. They struggle a little bit in that transition. But we did see Suarez get in two or three times, running down the sides of central defenders. On another day, Suarez would have scored two or three. I don't think we'll see him miss as many clear-cut chances as what he missed the day before. You know, statistically, Suarez scores almost one in two, so he's definitely due a goal.
What sort of mentality are the Saudis coming into this match with? Because they had that bit of a scare with their aeroplane as well a couple of days back. Lots of reports about them getting reprimanded, from Saudi Arabia for that performance. Talk about the coach, almost being on standby, that if he loses this match by a big margin, could be fired as early as Thursday. That's not a great mindset to go into this game with.
No, not at all. And if there's one country you don't want to mess around with, it obviously it's Saudi Arabia. I think they'll be a little bit nervous. They know the performance. It can't get any worse. So maybe the coach has probably got that message across to try and relax a bit. It can't get any worse than what's happened. Let's try and improve. But like you say, I think there'll be 100 CVs waiting to land tomorrow morning if Saudi Arabia lose as heavily as they did.
Okay. Ashley, I won't ask you for a prediction on this one, because I have a feeling that I know which way you're going to go. But with that, we've come to the end of the show today. Time to say thank you, of course, to Ashley Westwood for all your analysis and your tactical setup. We'll be back, of course, at 10:30 p.m. On WEON. But before we go, we thought it's right to show you how a team of 23 men kicked off the biggest party in Russia in decades. this party didn't end till early this morning. We're of course talking about Russia, who after that victory last night are on the brink of the knockout.